Hi everyone, my name is Courtney. I write under the pen names Lyra Parrish, and I'm one half of the USA Today bestselling duo Kennedy Fox. Today we're going to talk about some things that I've learned from self-publishing 40 books. It feels so weird to say. These are in no particular order, but one of the main things that came to mind when I sat down and really thought about how I felt and the things that I learned after publishing so many books was backlist is king. Backlists are essentially the books that you wrote years ago. They're not new, they're older, they've been out for a while. And I can tell you, when I was new, authors that I looked up to would say, backlist is everything. And I didn't understand that. And while my backlist sold, I made more money every time I released, so it encouraged me to release more. Releasing more then helps grow your backlist. It also shows your audience that you're consistent, and it all kind of works together. But once you have a lot of entry points for readers to find you and to fall in love with your books, backlist really is everything. And I finally understand that. As Kennedy Fox, we make a large majority of our money on our backlist, on our books that are years old. Still to this day, Checkmate Duet series is one of our best selling series. I think it'll be 5 years old in October. It sells really well. And I've also learned that when you complete a series, that's when you can really see the read through. Number two is about rebranding. I believe that rebranding old series is one of the best things that you can do for your backlist. And when I say rebranding, the sky is essentially the limit. If you follow Kennedy Fox on social media, you will see that we have done a lot of rebranding this year. We did a lot of rebranding last year, and it's just something that we like to do to make the books fresh. One cover may attract one type of reader and another cover may attract a different kind of reader. And so it always adds new life to a series when you rebrand it. Mostly when people talk about rebranding, they talk about rebranding covers. I can tell you that we have rebranded covers, we have rebranded series names, and we have also rebranded titles just to make it a more sellable package. We are very honest with our readers about our rebrands. We give people plenty enough time to order them in paperback. We also keep them in our shop until they sell out. So if someone wants to finish their collection in that series with a specific cover, we have that available. And you know what they say, like, people have to see stuff, is it like 5 times now, 7 times before they buy? It used to be 3, but that has now increased with the popularity of social media. If you have an older series that's 4 or 5 years old, change the blurb, change the cover, change whatever you have to change to rebrand. I understand that readers get very attached to covers and to titles and all of that, but at the end of the day, this is a business and you have to do what's going to help you find new people, that's going to help you sell more books, that's going to continue to push your backlist. Which brings me to my next point. You are always searching for new readers. I used to hear very successful authors say that, and it felt like a dumb moment for me. Like, of course you're always searching for new readers. But when you break it down, you realize that the same readers that started with you, that were your foundation, that were your hardcore, years from now, those people may not be with you. They may have switched to a different genre to read. They may have life-changing situations, so they don't really have time to read anymore. Number of different reasons why readers fall off, and it happens. And so the goal is to always find people to replace those who are no longer reading your books. At the point where you are no longer doing that, you become stagnant, and that's when it can be very scary because you're not seeing any growth and you're still producing books. To find new readers, you can do things like what we talked about in the previous point, which is rebranding. Number four is when you stop comparing yourself to other people, you become happier. This is something that I struggled with in the beginning of my career. I don't really struggle with it anymore because I've learned and I've grown and I understand things on a greater level than I did when I was new. But when I was at the very beginning of my career, I was just pushing so hard and I was seeing all of my friends move to the next level, and I felt like I wasn't going anywhere, that I was being left behind. And that really just got in my head, and it affected my productivity. And of course, while I was happy for the people that I was friends with, that they were making New York Times and USA Today and Wall Street Journal and making six figures in a month, you know, as I'm working a full-time job and struggling to keep up with everybody, and it just really put me in a bad place mentally. And so when I cut that off and I really just sat down and put the blinders on and focused on myself and my own career, started co-writing with Brooke and us pushing out books like no other, you know, things changed for me, because I realized that my journey is my own and your journey is your own. And playing the comparison game and looking at other people who started at the same time of you and going, oh, but this person is doing this and this person is doing that and they have this PR company and blah, blah, blah. And oh, they were in this. And like, why aren't these opportunities happening for me? It wasn't anything that had to do with me personally. It just wasn't my time yet. I still had a lot of stuff to learn. It's a hard thing to do, to not compare yourself to other people. And I think staying in your lane is the most important thing. Keep your head down, stay out of the drama, focus on what's important to you, and keep working, and it will happen. Another person's success does not affect yours whatsoever. There is enough room in self-publishing for every single person, for every single genre. It is not full. I have heard and seen things online about, oh, it's a waste of time to self-publish in 2021 and it's gonna be worse in 2022. Like, are you serious? Like, we have one of the best jobs that we could ever ask for. Readers do not just read one book and then they're done. It's not like we're trying to sell cars here, guys. We are talking about books, and there are people out there who read two books a day. And so there is enough room for every single person, and you should be happy for people when they're successful, because you have no idea how hard they worked to get there. At the beginning of my career, I had people who tried to take me down, who tried to out that I was writing under a pen name, who threatened me in ways that are just completely disgusting. And it really kind of like knocked me down a little bit. And it was because I was a good person to have in their life until I became competition. And that mindset, I think, just needs to go from everyone. Someone else's success does not affect you in any way. So stay in your lane, stay positive, keep moving forward, keep working hard, keep pushing, and you will be able to accomplish your goals. And number five, bank before rank. I know that some of you are gonna be like, Courtney, what does that mean? Well, congratulations, I am going to explain it to you. And I don't know who originated this saying. It's been around, I can remember as far as back from 2017. And it's something that authors who are wide, who are on all platforms, it's a saying that they tend to say a lot. Bank before rank. That means money before rank. And that's because when you are in Kindle Unlimited, which I have a video that kind of explains this, I will put a link up above. When you're in Kindle Unlimited, the algorithm is weighted in your favor. So let's say we're both 25,000. I sell five books, it drops me to 15,000. You sell five books, it drops you to 10,000. That's what it's like. And also, it comes from when you release and you have pre-order up. Yes, your rank may not be that great, but you could have thousands of pre-orders. This is money that you will receive. I would rather know that on release day, we're gonna make $10,000 compared to, oh, on release day, we're gonna be ranked top 100 on Amazon, because your rank is not reflective of the money that you're making. I see people who are on all platforms, they rank really well on release day. They're like top 1,000, and then you go to Apple and they are number two in the Apple store, and they're ranking in all the other countries too. That's what happens to us as Kennedy Fox. We typically drop below 500 on release day on Amazon. If we were in Kindle Unlimited, I know that we would be lower, but Y'all know how I feel about KU. I won't even start on that. Make your money before your rank, because at the end of the day, no one's gonna remember the rank, but you will remember how much money is put into your bank account from that release. To me, I don't even really watch rank anymore. The reason I know that we are ranked what we are is because Brooke watches it and she sends me screenshots. Otherwise, I'm not looking at it. I typically know how many pre-orders we have. It's just a really fun time to sit back and relax and not worry about rank. Number six, some aspects of publishing and releasing gets easier, but it doesn't mean it's less stressful. Like, of course, I could write all of you a checklist of what you need to do on release day, what you need to do right before your release, what you need to do a few days after release. I could write this out, okay? But the thing is like, it doesn't mean that just because you know exactly what you're doing, that it's not going to be stressful. I can tell you now that we are no longer in Kindle Unlimited, it's a lot less stressful. Just because you release a lot of books doesn't mean that you haven't made. There is a thing called reader expectation. If you ask hardcore Kennedy Fox readers what they expect in a book, and then we release a book that does not meet those expectations, our reviews are going to be bad because we have branded ourselves in a specific way where our readers know exactly what they're going to get. Reader expectation is something that keeps us within the lines. Do we sometimes color outside of those lines? Do we teeter against those lines? Absolutely. Just because you release a lot of books and you have a lot of books out, I'm not going to say that it gets easier. At some points, it does get a little bit more stressful because you want to keep the people who love you. You want to keep those readers who want to binge all of your books, and you want to meet their expectations at every corner. And so that's what we try to do. And so yes, it does make it a little bit more stressful. Number seven, I think that releasing consistently helps you keep your mind in the game, and it also shows your readers that you are serious, that you are going to continue to produce books that they love and that they want to read. It's one of the reasons why we put pre-orders up so far in advance. We want people to know what's coming. We want people to know that we are consistent, that we do stick with our release dates. I have friends who haven't released in a long while, and so it's kind of like starting over. And although I say a long while, I'm talking like a year. And in self-publishing, a year feels like a decade because so many things are constantly changing in the industry that when you go back to it, it's like, whoa, this is different. Whoa, Amazon's dashboard is different. What has Barnes & Noble done? iTunes producer needs what? I mean, there's some things that just change. And when you're consistently releasing, you don't really notice them. It's a little change here, it's a little change there. And then someone who hasn't released, it's like, holy crap, this is completely different. I think I need to relearn this. If you are one of those people who haven't released in a long while, it's not too late. You can start being consistent tomorrow. Release a book in 2 months. Just make sure that you've got your next book ready. Then you can update that back matter so then people know what's coming. Being consistent, I feel, is one of the key reasons why we have been so successful. The next thing I have to say is you have to be writing what you love. I don't think that I could have written 40 books in a genre that I did not actually enjoy writing in. And people are always like, oh, but it's romance, you know, like people always discredit my genre. I'm used to it at this point. Haters gonna hate. People don't even understand how much work goes into it, but okay, whatever. You can have your opinion. I will have mine because I'm actually doing the work for it. But you have to enjoy what you're doing or it's going to feel like a struggle. It's gonna feel like you're walking through quicksand trying to make it to the end of this next book and then you just do it on repeat. I honestly can't imagine writing something that I didn't like. That would be torture. There's no way that I would be able to. There's no way. If I hated the books, I would be like, Brooke, I can't write this. This sucks. This is horrible. And she knows that if I hated it, I would tell her. And I think that's why it's important to find something that you love. Find a genre that makes you excited. Find a genre that you just think about all the time. And that's me with romance. I love thrillers. I love contemporary fiction, something that I figured out last year or really in 2019. And while I would love to write that stuff, I don't think that I could release 6 to 8 thriller books per year, 6 to 8 contemporary books per year. Which is why I want to branch out in other genres. It will be a traditionally published thing because that publishing schedule is a lot slower than self-publishing. And also, just because you love your genre doesn't mean that it's just going to be so easy and you're just going to be able to push out books. Writing is work. Writing is hard work, and you have to remember that. It's not easy. I don't care what genre you write. Writing is not an easy job. It can be difficult. You can have writer's block. You can be uninspired. You can have things happen in your life that just completely throw you off guard, where you're like, oh my God, writing this chapter would probably literally kill me right now, which has happened to me in a genre that I love. And so I think it's important, if you're a writer, find the things that you love to write and stick with that. And sure, branch out, try other genres, try different things, read different genres, read different things too. But at the end of the day, if you are a urban fantasy author and you realize that you really don't love writing urban fantasy, it's okay to change your genre. It's okay to try other things. Number 9, test everything. Don't follow your peers blindly. That's all I have to say. Test it all. If someone says, hey, your cover sucks, test it. Get some Facebook ads going. You can make it where people who are following your page does not see it, and test your cover. See which one gets the most clicks to your website. Also, remember that as you're testing things, you can always change your covers back. As a self-published author, we have the ability to change ebook covers like every hour if you wanted to. Don't do that because that's really annoying. But the thing is like, you have the ability to test a cover. If a book's not selling, you know the book is great, you've had great reviews, test a different cover. See if you get more sales. Test different categories. See if you find new readers that way. Test it all, because what works for one author may not work for you. Test your Facebook ads, test your images, test your covers, test your blurbs, test it all. You have the ability to do that with Facebook ads. Asking the question to your reader is, which cover do you like best? It doesn't matter. If they are in your group, they are already on board with you. You need to figure out what people who are not already one of your readers, what they want. And you figure that out by testing. Number 10. Don't be afraid to do something new. I know that sounds cliche. I wouldn't be where I am today if I wouldn't have been like, hey, let's co-write. I was getting ready to start a new pen name anyway, and Brooke was like, hey, I've always wanted to co-write. I've got this book that I've kind of started. And she sent me the first chapter. If I would have been like, no, I'm not doing that. Like, I'm not co-writing. I don't even want to try anything new. I just want to do my own thing. I would not have quit my job. I'd probably still be working corporate and hating my life. But because I went out on a limb and I was like, you know, what else do I have to lose at this point? I'm completely starting over. It'll be fun to have somebody to work with, to talk to keep me accountable, and vice versa. And if I would have not done that, then I think my life would have been completely different. I don't even know if I would have had a YouTube channel. And that all goes back to trying something new. Also, be aware that everything that you try out may not be a hit. It may be a failure, and that's okay, as long as you learn something from that mistake. You have to make mistakes to grow. That's just the bottom line. I am very good at making mistakes. I'm very good at saying, yeah, that's a perfect cover, and then 2 years later looking back at it and going, that was a terrible idea. I think all of those little failures really help build the roadblocks to success. They're just as important. Number 11, those who are at the top will not always stay there, and those who are at the bottom will not always stay there. I have personally experienced this, and I was denied access to signings because I had not made a list. They just wanted USA Today or New York Times or Wall Street Journal best-selling authors. And at that point, I had not made a list. And I felt excluded from a lot of things like that because I was not a list maker. It was very hard for me to understand that because I had a pretty large readership. I was in the process of growing. I was excluded from a lot of things, and it really hurt me on a personal level. Funny enough, Kennedy Fox made USA Today 4 times in a year. And at that point, nobody knew who was behind Kennedy Fox. And then it was outed who we were. After that, it was funny because I started getting messages from people. Oh, would you like to come to the signing? Or would you like to do this? Would you like to do that? And I was just like, you didn't want me beforehand, but now I'm good enough. And it didn't sit well with me, so I declined a lot of stuff. Just because someone is not at this expectation today does not mean tomorrow they won't be there or above that. There are authors who have never made USA Today and then they go and make it like 6 weeks in a row. Their books are ranking high and everybody wants to be their friends, and it's just a really gross feeling to see how that happens. And I've seen it a lot in my career. It's why I keep my author friend group very small, because a lot of the time it's because people want to use me or take advantage of me. It doesn't feel good. You can tell when those relationships are just super forced or when people just want something out of you. The more that we grow as Kennedy Fox, the more that I see it. And so that's why I am very careful with who I let into my life. Once you start making lists and you start selling really well, that's when people are like, oh, she can actually do something for me now, so I want to be her friend. And with me, I don't want relationships like that, and it happens a lot. So if you are just building your brand and you feel that you're being left out because of lists or whatever the case is, just remember this. When you do, I'm not going to say if, I'm going to say when you do make those lists, when you do sell 5,000 copies in a day, 5 days in a row, people will come out of the woodworks to track you down, to try to be your friend, to try to take advantage of you. And just be careful who you trust. That's all I'm going to say. Be careful who you trust. Stay out of drama. Stay in your lane. There are some shady people out there. The final thing that I have to say is keep going. Keep going. It's not going to be easy. It took me a decade to get where I am. But if you want to write and if you want to be a full-time author, you have to keep going. There is no end game. There is no goalpost. It does not exist. You have to keep going, keep moving forward, keep pushing, keep making mistakes, and just enjoy the journey, because that's what it's about. I will never be at a point where I'm like, okay, I've done it all. I can stop writing now. That doesn't exist. And I know for many of you, a large majority of you, it's the same thing. So try to enjoy the journey. Celebrate the small wins. Okay, celebrate the big accomplishments too. And just remember, it's not the really big things that lead to your success. It's all the little stepping stones that you follow along your journey that gets you to the next level. Writing is a creative outlet. Writing makes me happy. Writing is something that I really look forward to, that I actually enjoy doing. And so, stop and smell the roses. Reward yourself. You're doing a good job, and stay in your lane and don't compare yourself to anybody else. And that's pretty much it. I hope to record a video like this every 10 books. So like the next one will be 50 books, 60 books, 70 books, whatever. It was really fun to kind of sit back and think about things over the last 7 years that have happened, and like things that I've learned, and like life lessons with self-publishing, and just different situations that I've had happen to me in the publishing industry. And it was a good time to reflect, and I'm so happy that I was able to share that with you guys. As always, I appreciate you guys so much. If you haven't subscribed yet, please do that. I'm still on target to make 10,000 subscribers in 2021. It might happen, it might not, and if it doesn't, that's okay. I'm not gonna cry over spilt milk. I've had enough crying this year, so I will not cry over that. But anyway, I love you guys. I hope you'll have an amazing, incredible week. You accomplish all your goals and you write all the words, and I'll see you again in my next video. Bye, guys.